good morning. It is very good to be here with all of you. I especially want to welcome those of you who are new or visiting. It is really, really good to have you with us. Things will look a little different in church today. We are kicking off our program year and celebrating with having a choir back in our midst. We have changed up our liturgy. We're drawing on the Anglican Church of New Zealand. And what else is new? Oh, Sunday school started. So Will Scott is over in Sunday school. He will be back at the Peace. I've been gone for 2 weeks camping in the Sierras and then down at Big Sur with church people. So it was work. it was hard work. And it's really good to be back here with all of you. Our service continues at the top of page 5. Grace to you and peace from God our Creator, the love at our beginning and without end, in our midst and with us.
God is with us, here in our new life.
We say together, Almighty
God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Some escape us, some we cannot face.
We are gathered together doing all kinds of new things in church today, a new liturgy. We have our choir back. There's a new banner hanging out front which says, "Who is God calling you to be?" After the service, we're going to have a big party over in the parish hall. There is a bouncy house, which by 11:30 may be more like a slip and slide. There's going to be a ministry fair and hot dogs and hamburgers and a raffle. We are all together celebrating being together. But I have a question as we do this, and it is, why? Why do we bother getting together in church anymore? Church is really not trending these days. It's dismal, the attendance numbers in this country, especially on the West Coast. Just yesterday, the Pew Research Center released some new data that says that within a couple of decades, Christianity will no longer be the majority of Americans. This is a religion in decline. Not all of you got out of bed on a rainy Sunday and came here. You could have stayed in bed and watched it on your phone. You could have gone on the couch and watched the NFL. Something drew you here. But when I try to answer what is it that draws people to church, I have a surprisingly hard time articulating that. And that makes me nervous for someone in my line of work. And the question, why bother coming to church? It's not idle. So many people don't see the point anymore. And that may be because we are still holding on to the traditional reason for coming to church. And we heard that in our gospel reading today. The most famous line in the whole gospel from John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." If you had stayed home and turned on ESPN, you probably would have seen that quote in the end zone. Someone holding up a big sign that says John 3:16. It boils down Christianity to its simplest form, right? Believe the right things about Jesus, you get to go to heaven. If not, probably not. It's really simple, right? The trouble with simplifying Christianity this much is that it completely misinterprets John 3:16. Specifically, it garbles the words belief, eternal, and world. It also flattens John's theology. John's theology is this rich, mysterious, swirling, relational game. And this turns it into a formula for getting yourself into heaven. And that's the real problem, because John 3:16 can invert Christianity. So that Christianity becomes an effort to get ourselves out of this world and get ourselves safe, ignoring all these people who are left behind. And that betrays the spirit of the whole gospel. So this morning, what I'd like to do is take a closer look at this traditional rationale for coming to church and see what we might learn from it. Let's start with that line, "For God so loved the world." Right off the bat, we're on shaky ground, because the world is actually not a very good translation. The word in the Greek is cosmos, or creation, all of creation. The oceans and the sky, the birds and the sea, the birds in the air, the fish in the sea. I guess there are seabirds. They're included too. The redwoods and the oak trees, the creepy crawly things on the ground. Even those of us who walk around self-consciously on two legs. All of these things, all of creation is included in God's love. Whereas in the traditional reading, most of creation seems to be left behind because they believe the wrong big enough to include everybody. All right, next we get the humdinger. Whoever believes in him, believes. Many of us have learned that Christianity is about believing the right things. It's about saying the Nicene Creed without crossing your fingers. But that is not what belief meant back in Jesus' day. As one scholar I read put it, the word pisteo, belief, is fully grounded in relationship. To believe is not simply a mental exercise, but an all-embracing relationship, an attitude of love and trust in God. Believing something doesn't mean thinking the right way. It means giving your heart to someone else and holding their fragile heart in return. It means being in a relationship. And as we all know, if you argue about who's right in a relationship, it's not a very good relationship. You need to give the other person a little more grace. The other dimension of belief that we fail to capture usually is that in Jesus' day, it was communal. Religion was not an individual exchange between a human and a God. Religion was a community process in which God strives to bring the whole tribe of Israel, the whole kingdom of God, in relationship with God. So belief ripples through a community. It includes our neighbors. It even includes the people who believe the wrong things and the people we don't like. All right, then we get eternal life. The shorthand translation of that is heaven. Eternal means time after time, minute after minute, hour after hour, surrounded by fluttering naked baby angels. Right? That is not at all the spirit that Jesus was talking about. Back in this day, when Jesus said eternal, he meant life that begins now, that takes on a different character or quality. Think of it as life with four dimensions, or going from black and white to color TV, or from mono to stereo. Think of this as life with a taco truck on every corner. One way to capture that idea is that think about the time you spend alone versus the time you spend with the person you love. It takes on an entirely different character. That eternalness begins now and here, but it extends into the future. It starts with the way we live right now, this eternal life, because we have a role in making it. But we help carry our whole community through relationships into the future with God. This idea that we believe in God and create a new world. This is a group project. A group project in which we help make God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Christianity is in the business of making a new creation by loving it into being. Try to put that on a poster board in the end zone. So I want to circle back around to the question I started with. Given all this, what is the point of coming to church on a Sunday morning? It's clearly not very relevant to most people. In the Diocese of California, the Episcopal Diocese of California, dozens of churches are teetering on closure because they just don't have enough people. Right here in Alameda, many of our neighboring churches no longer reflect the age or the ethnicity or the numbers of their neighborhoods. They're not God calling us to be? And what is the point of church? Why do we spend our energy doing these things? The old answers about tradition and salvation and guilt aren't working. I feel like we have a good story to tell about relationships, but we have a hard time telling it. So over the next year, I want your help answering the question, why come to church? Why be Christian? Why follow Jesus? We have to give our neighbors better answers. Amen. We have a whole bunch of announcements. Some out looking for our children. We will find the children and bring them into church. Turn to page 20, maybe? Okay. After church, we're having a party. Bouncy house, hot dogs and hamburgers and sweets, and all the ministries have tables set up. And if you go in there, you'll find a little sheet of paper with places for signatures from each ministry in our little ministry fair. And if you get all the signatures from each ministry, those sheets will then be entered into a raffle to win dinner at Will Scott's house or at my house. For reference, Will is a much better cook. Right. I'm going to let Will talk about youth and children's stuff because we are very busy with that. Over the next few weeks, we're going to celebrate the first ever Alameda Pride celebration. That takes place on October the 8th. We're going to have a big group from our church. Talk to Melanie McMullen, who's over here, or find her email address in the bulletin. Our prayer bench is back after communion. If you'd like some individual prayers, make your way over towards our columbarium. During the month of October, we're going to run a series for newcomers. You can find that on page 23. Over 3 Sundays, we'll talk about meeting Jesus in the building, meeting Jesus in history and culture, and meeting Jesus together. Our next Enlightening in a Bottle book is up on October 11th. It is called Until the End of Time, Mind, Matter, and Our Search for Meaning in an Evolving Universe. We'll talk about that at the 1400 Bar and Grill down on West End. All right, since our kids are not here yet, I'm going to invite my friend Lynn Morker to come on up. Lynn her title just changed, but she was, until she got promoted again, she's the executive director of Head Start for all of Alameda, including the Head Start program that is expanding here at our site. And we are giving away our plate collection for the whole month of September to support the good work they do. Lynn.
To be invited today to talk with you all about the programs that we run.
will be with us during coffee hour if you want to learn more about all that good work. We still have a missing priest, and we've lost all the children, so I'm going to make the children's announcements.
They're lining up.
All right. So Sunday school began today. If you haven't registered your child and you'd like to, you can use the QR code at the back of this leaflet. You can also use that QR code to donate to our cause of the month, Head Start. This afternoon, youth group begins, and middle school is at 5 o'clock. I'm looking at someone who can tell me if I'm wrong. 4? Thank you. Middle school is at 4 o'clock. High school is at 5. There's going to be a bouncy house and all kinds of shenanigans. Next week's youth group is an escape room in San Francisco. The youth are all going to get together and ride a ferry over to the city, and then we're going to lock them in a room and go away. And we'll just, I don't know, we'll go get dinner or something. All right, there, here they come. Let me finally remind all of you that this altar is God's table, and everyone is invited to join us for communion. Walk in love with Christ. Come to our table with joy and thanksgiving.
We will fail.
your will and be fulfilled in your love. You send your Son to be for us the way we need to follow and the church and the truth we need to know. You send your Holy Spirit to strengthen and to guide, to warn and to revive your church. With all your witnesses who surround us on every side, countless as heaven's stars, we praise you for our creation and our calling, with loving and with joyful hearts.
Soul, joy, and sorrow given for you.
We
Please join me in the post-communion prayer at the top of page 18. Let us pray. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We who the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us alive in the hope that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, who creates, sustains, and redeems us, be upon you and remain with you always.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.